So I'm a beamline scientist in beamline B24. I'm a microbiologist, so I work with human pathogens, and I try to study their clearance. The model that I use are phagocytes from a model organism that is called Drosophila melanogaster. So it's the common fruit fly that we find occasionally on the vinegar, on the wine. It's a black, small, tiny fly. So I use the larvae from this fly and I extract the hemocytes from the larvae. I'm using grids, EM grids. And as soon as I extract the hemocytes, I leave them to settle down on grids. Then I infect them. I cryo-freeze them at different time points, depending on which is the time point of interest that I have. And I then cryopreserve them. And finally, I use our two main modalities, our tomograph and our cryostructure illumination microscope, to visualize the infection and try to track the clearance pathway. What we take advantage is the high homology of the genome of the fly compared to the human genome. And the other thing that we take advantage is the fact that we can find within the larvae of the fly, we can find what is called professional phagocytes. They are dedicated hemocytes that have as main function the phagocytosis of the pathogens. Pathogen could be fungal strains, bacterial strains. In our case, we use a very clever human pathogen, which is called Staphylococcus. So we are aimed to find where it is hiding within the cell. And as a further target, we would like to provide to the scientific community the spots where within the cell that the Staphylococcus is hiding. And as a second aim, we would like to use these spots as potential targets for drug development. It is a very common pathogen. It is actually an opportunistic pathogen. So it becomes pathogenic when it reaches specific levels of expansion. So most of our people carry Staphylococcus on, for example, between our fingers, on top of our skin. But during specific circumstances, for example, under immunosuppression, in those cases, Staphylococcus could bypass our skin, could infect our blood, and it can cause what we call bacteremia. So it reaches toxic levels and it can become very harmful for our hemocytes and our general health. One part is our personal research. So each member of the staff has his own research portfolio. But on top of that, one of the main things that we do is we provide support to the user community. And hopefully as soon as the users will become familiar with our techniques, they gain more independency. But especially through their first visits in our beamline, it's very important to go next to the user, discuss the specifications of their project, and develop on collaboration with the user their strategy. I think that's a very important step on the whole process, because this defines the next steps. Another thing that we do, which is a major part of our job, is that we supervise students. So we have students at various levels, ranging from summer students that are visitors in our beamline for 3 months. And then we have also what we call year in industry students, which can be part of their bachelor or master studies, and we supervise them for 12 months. And then we have also PhD students, and we also supervise them, and we work close to them, providing support and guidance through their studies. As we always recommend to the user, is talk to us. So the very first point is to come in contact with us. So the user sent an email, make a call, and we first thinking about the project, the demands of the project, and the ambitions that the user has. And what we first check is the feasibility of doing a project here, and also if we can correspond to user demands, and also to the specific to the specifications of each project. So we discuss a lot with the user. We check together some preliminary data. Always preliminary data provide some guidance and some first proofs of feasibility. And we then recommend to the user to proceed with an application through our UAS system. Afterwards, this goes through a review process, and if the user is awarded with BIM time, we then allocate each user with specific BIM time, and we define the specific date for the visits. Now, the next step is we ask the user to send the samples here. Alternatively, the user can visit the BIM line with his own cell line and do part of the initial wet lab work here. We have all the facilities and equipment that is necessary to support a cell culture and cryo-freeze it, store it, and then wait for the user's visit. As soon as the visitor is here, we discuss again with more details this time. We develop together a strategy focusing on the specific time points that the user wants to record through a process within a cell. And then we provide to the user an estimate of the workload that he can cover through a daily visit. And we go together through the data collection. So that's the big thing. We load the sample on our tomograph. We collect data through the tomograph. That's one scenario. Now, if the cells have what we call floor data, before the tomograph collection, we use our cryo-sim microscope to collect this floor data, and we follow with the tomograph, and we keep collecting data. Through the collection, we inform the users about all the necessary software that is available, and the software that he or she wants has to become familiar in order to process the data after the collection. And as soon as the user's visitor ends, he's available either to take the data at the end of his visit, or he could collect the data remotely while he returns to his lab. And then we keep providing support regarding the processing of the data, which is a time-consuming thing, and it needs a lot of effort.